Morning, Dave.
Morning.
And morning, David. Morning, everyone. We are excited to be here. I have my buddy Patrick Connor and myself to introduce the concepts on how to disrupt the entrenched competitor and truly win the business that you deserve. Patrick, let's go ahead and get started and talk about, tell us a little bit about you and ourselves, okay, as we move forward into this process.
Okay. First thing, I want to say hello and welcome. I'm glad that you're here. Glad that we can have this time together. Let me begin by introducing Paul Cherry. Paul and, of course, Paul and I have been working together about, 15 years now, Paul?
I believe so, Patrick.
Paul is the president and founder of Performance-Based Results. He's had over 20 years of experience, of course, in effective sales strategy and training of salespeople. He's been featured in several magazines, Selling Power Incorporated and Kiplinger's Personal Finance and Investor's Business Daily. He's worked with over 1,200 clients to date in just about every major industry. Paul is the author of Questions That Sell, which was published by the American Management Association, and he and I had the privilege of working together and authoring Questions That Get Results. On a personal side, Paul has two teenage daughters that keep him very busy and a lovely wife named Claire, but just a great family man and a good businessman.
And as Patrick always says, that I married well above myself. I do agree, and the same for him. Patrick
That's
Connor,
nice
my mentor. He is my inspiration. I've worked with him for close to 14 years. And every day, every session, I'm always learning something new. He brings a lot of expertise in what I call the sales and sales leadership and the strategic areas. He's worked with a major global organization, training organization based in Hong Kong, throughout Asia and the rest of the world. It is thrilling. We did work on our book, Questions That Gets Results, together. So thank you, Patrick, for being able to join me today, because both of us are here to address some of those challenges and frustrations that you have on really how to engage those prospective customers, but also those established customers where you're getting a piece of the business, but you realize you want more, right? So let's get started and talk about some of those issues. Let me ask you. Are these the problems you're facing when trying to disrupt that relationship, where that person is just fearful of change, fearful of the unknown? So what do? They seem to be, they want to stay put with what is comfortable.
It almost becomes like a bias, Paul, where they're really entrenched with that. And there's not only the challenge to leave somebody that you're very comfortable with, but there's a bias that comes along with it.
That's right. And they may be satisfied, but the fact is, are they passionate about that existing vendor? And the other thing we have to be attentive to is that when you're trying to get in there, recognize, though, that it isn't just about your product, but recognize some of the internal conflicts or priorities. And we want to leverage that, because when somebody says, we're satisfied, we're happy with what we're currently doing now, my question to all of us, though, is, does that mean everyone is? So I need to be lifting up a lot of stones and find out somebody who's unhappy in that existing opportunity. We also have to identify that there are certain individuals, when it comes to disrupting that relationship, is there a lack of focus, a lack of clarity? Are they indecisive? Are they in a state of denial? Or, as I said, complacency. Whose job is it to shake things up? Theirs or ours? It's ours. So we're going to look at ways to make that happen. Because as you look at these bullet points, our job is to find some emotional drivers. And if we can find those emotional drivers, that's our opportunity.
Well, so often, Paul, too, you hear people say, you know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And the truth is that we could really offer these companies, these organizations, something far better than they're currently getting. But we need to discover where the issues are, where these challenges are that we can address. And that becomes the problem, because they honestly feel, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
There you go. And here's the challenge all of us are facing today. And that is, This was a study done by the Dartnell Research Institute to really understand the percentage of time that prospects and customers are not telling us what is on their minds. And unfortunately, that percentage is high, about 80% of the time. So here's where I'm going with that. When somebody is saying, I'm satisfied, I'm happy, everything's good, check back with me in 6 months, or we'll kick this around, or we're under a contractual agreement, are we really hearing the truth? Because there's something. What is it they're telling me? More importantly, what is it they're not telling me? And what is the motivation? If I can get to that motivation, you have a much greater chance. So we can't listen to that lip service when they're telling us we're happy or content. Because the reality is, it's not the truth.
So what you're saying is that there are issues there that either they're not opening up to us, they're not sharing them with us. There are hidden issues. It may be service, it may be delivery, it may be even a more competitive price, or they don't see quite the value that they might be getting, and they're kind of closed from that. But what they don't tell us, that they hide these things
and they dismiss us. Check back with me, call me later, leave me some information, I'll throw you a bone, give you something to bid or quote on. But the reality is we're not getting to the heart of the matter and we get brushed off. And what do? We too fall in a state of complacency. And what does that mean? What do we say back? Okay, fine, not a problem. When should I get back to you? When should I touch base? When should when can I come back and see if I could do a presentation? We're not getting to the heart of the issue.
Can I send you some samples?
That's right.
Can I give you a try for this? And then, of course, when we follow up with the samples, they haven't even tried them.
That's right. And here, and take this study further, because what Dartnell Research also says, we have a great message. Think about it. We know we're better. We know we're more competitive. We know we're more cost effective, safer, efficient, more productive, more powerful, whatever our message is. Our challenge is this, though, when disrupting the entrenched competitor, and that is the percentage of time that they're listening, it's low. And our messaging is falling on deaf ears. So my question is, how do we disrupt an entrenched competitor when we got these kind of barriers? And I call it, what I call is, it's the emotional barriers that are blocking us. And the fact is, these folks don't want to have confrontation. The fact is that they're in a complacent mode and it's safer just to do what's tried and true, but I'll keep you in my pocket because if anything happens down the road, you know what, maybe I can use you. Or maybe they'll use us for negotiating leverage because they want to get a price or try something, knowing that they can go back to that existing vendor and drive home even a better bargain.
Send me a proposal, Paul, go back to that other slide. What is the percentage? What is the percentage? No, the second one, next one. What is the percentage of time that they don't actively listen?
20%.
That's significant. Are you saying that 80% of the time they're really not even listening to us?
That's right. We're going to get into what I call the unique selling proposition. We're going to talk about the elevator pitches. And you know what? The problem is these are ineffective because they're not even paying attention. You crafted a great message in email or voicemail or live, or you're giving a presentation to a group. It's falling on deaf ears.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So in setting the stage and looking at some strategies, we'll give you the concept. You've probably seen a concept like this. It's called the sales bridge process. And Patrick is going to take you through this process because especially as it applies to an entrenched competitor and how it applied to an organization in Canada that we worked with in terms of disrupting an entrenched competitor who was with this company for 25 years. Patrick? Take us through that.
The idea, of course, is that fortunately, with technology today, we have a huge advantage in that we can do a tremendous amount of research, gathering information, finding out who the decision maker is, or at least leading us in that direction to do a tremendous amount of discovery. Before we ever make the call. And that's the research step. All professionals need to do research. And of course, you're familiar with many of the different tools and opportunities that we have to research. We can no longer walk in the door blind that people used to do. Today we need to have information or we don't even deserve to make the call. So that's
my recommendation is there's a really good resource out there, and it's called Take the Cold Out of Cold Calling by Sam Richter. The beauty of today's selling environment is that it's actually easier to sell today from a planning perspective. Why is that? Because we have so much access to information, whether it's the social media, the LinkedIn, the blogging, all the resources, databases that are available. Our challenge, though, is because we too are rushed for time, pushed and pulled in a lot of directions. Our challenge is, are we doing enough planning? And according to some great research by the American Management Association, that 50% of the outcome is dictated before one word is exchanged. So is planning important? You better believe it.
That's the research. The resource you mentioned was Take the Cold. What was it called again?
Take the Cold Out of Cold Calling by Sam Richter. It's a great book, and it really gives you some great insight on tools and techniques, to all the latest information that's available from a planning or research standpoint.
Excellent. After we've done that planning, we go on to step two, which is receptivity. That is the approach. That's the opening, it's called. That's where we're selling ourselves. That's where we're walking in the door and establishing immediate rapport. Yeah, I'm not talking about the weather. I'm not talking about business conditions. I'm talking about opening the sale in a meaningful way so that we achieve receptivity. That is the first thing we're selling is we're selling ourselves. We're really establishing that immediate rapport, because in order to go further, we've got to build up the relationship. And how much of selling is based on relationship? Just a tremendous amount. And yet at that same time, we're still building trust, credibility, at least to move on to the next step. We're going to ask the customer to open up and to give us information. In order for them to do that, they need to have an idea that there's something in it for them, that they can benefit, and that we can. And think about this. When we walk in the door, is that customer thinking positive or negative?
They're thinking negative.
Yeah, I'll visualize that person is sitting at their desk, they're working on their computer, they're looking at a project, they're behind in their work, they've seen two salespeople so far today, and what have those salespeople done to their time? That they feel like it's been wasted, and then in we walk and we say, hi, and they're thinking, goodbye. So the idea is we need to create that receptivity. Which is
otherwise very, your challenge is that they're going to shut you down. I only got 10 minutes. Shoot. What do you got?
Yep.
Give me the information. I'm really busy. Got too much going on. I'm under a contractual agreement right now. We're happy. We're content. You see how they brush us off. If you don't really focus on that receptivity.
And with the entrenched customer, with that entrenched, if he's entrenched with your competitor, that doubles and makes it, three times more difficult to establish the rapport. So unless we're specific, unless we're designed in that area, it's very difficult to go any further. You think about this, how easy it is to close somebody if we don't have a good relationship with them. Near to impossible. So that's why this step is so important. Then we bridge from their receptivity into the heart of the actual presentation, which is discovery. Mm-hmm. It's interesting that so many people think that solution is the heart. No, discovery is the heart, because discovery is where the real relationship is built. And it's based on our ability to ask good questions, to get our customers to open up, to begin to tell us the truth, to begin to share with us what the real issues are that they're facing, and the opportunities, the ability to share with us the decision-making process. But all of this is discoveries, and all professionals do discovery.
So Patrick, take us through that example in which you worked for an organization that partnered with companies about their donor programs, all right, in which they turned to you to really fine tune their presentation because it was all about disrupting an entrenched competitor. Walk us through that example.
But that example goes back to creating the receptivity and then into discovery. The receptivity was important because they had done an excellent job of getting the opportunity to make a presentation to a board, a decision-making board. So it was an excellent opportunity. And you know, with any presentation, people usually walk in the door and they say, here's who we are, here's how we're qualified, here's the work that we've done before, here's how we know your industry.
And here's what makes us different, here's the clients that we've worked with, here's why you should do business with us. And it's all, the problem is it's all me, me, me. No wonder why these kind of prospective customers you're trying to disrupt are shutting us down when we go in there talking about me.
Patrick. So our purpose was to disrupt that, to change it. And what we said was, no. They're not interested in you as much as they're interested in themselves and their own issues and their own problems. So don't begin by talking about you. Begin by talking about them. Begin by talking about where they've come from and what was important to the customer. So they began and changed the whole structure of the presentation to center around the client, the customer. The beautiful part was one of the board members came up to them after the presentation and said, you know, it's amazing because you know more about us and our issues and our challenges than a lot of our current vendors. We've been working with vendors for some of them for 25 years, and you know more about us than they do, which was the key, of course, to opening up that account and to pull it away from that entrenched competitor. That made all the difference in the world. But all of this information that we gather in discovery comes back to solution. In the solution step is where we package our product, our services, our competitive advantage based around what we found out in discovery. Then it becomes a person-centered presentation.
So as we take you through these concepts now, to really focus on what's going to be the heart of the matter, we're going to go through this. We talked about planning, the importance of planning, that 50% of the outcome occurs before one word is exchanged. Our challenges, are we talking to the right people? So if somebody is saying, you know, we're satisfied, we're content, I mean, are you dealing with somebody who does not really have the final authority? So my recommendation is when somebody's blocking and tackling, are you looking for ways to find out who else is involved? And we had a company in Michigan that was hitting a roadblock. They were only getting $80,000 of business. They said, Paul, you know what? We're going to might be stepping on some toes, but we recognize if we can get to the right people, we got a $5 million opportunity here. And they said, you know what, we're going to go after the CEO because we want to talk about that strategic message, how we can impact profitability, growth, and success. You know, it was a leap of faith what they did. And I got an email from them just 2 days ago, and they said, you know, we met with the CEO, and they're endorsing us and saying, you know, we now need to, they put us in front of the senior vice president of safety and HR. Am I recommending you step on people's toes? No. But make sure we get to the right people. So if you're not happy with the feedback, keep digging and digging deeper, broader, and higher to find the right kind of person. Why? Because somebody who may not be in favor, there's probably an opposing force of somebody who is aligned with you. I also want to be looking at insider information. And what do I mean by insider information? And that is when I talk to the right people, and sometimes they're not the decision makers. One is a manufacturing of snack foods. And they were talking to the purchasing people about potato slicing machines, $500,000 opportunity here. And they were just getting shut down. Ah, no, we're happy, we're content. If we're gonna look at anything, we might consider price. Well, they started talking to the people on the production line, those people making only $12 an hour. And it was interesting because as they really got there on the line to find out what's going on, they're finding out that this one piece of equipment is breaking down. How often? Once a month. How long? About 24 hours. Started digging a little bit deeper and saying, wait a minute. So how many bags of potato chips aren't getting filled here on an hourly basis? 5,000 bags. Well, what's that a bag worth? $2. You're telling me $10,000 over 24 hours? Wait a minute. What is that? $250,000? How long has this been going on for? Almost a year? You're telling me $250,000? See where I'm going with this? The inside information, there's something. Information is power, and our job is making sure that we can ask the right questions. So we touched upon the opening and why it's important that elevator pitches and USPs, unique selling propositions. The fact is that if they're not listening, we got to move on. We got to move on to what's important. What's important? It's all about them. My recommendation is you got to tell stories. Stories. Stories are powerful and persuasive. Stories get to the emotions. And when emotions and logic cross, which one rules? Emotions do. So what are some of the stories that we can tell here that are joining us today that's going to persuade and motivate to say, ah, that's my problem. I can relate to that. So, you know, for example, we were dealing with one organization and they talked about those problems. One organization was selling mops and brooms and disposable items. Talk about commodity and price-driven situation. That's a hard, hard business. So what they said is we're going to focus on a specific vertical market. And it's all going to be about food safety and sanitation. Why? Because of the FDA regulations, the scares with listeria and every other kind of particle intrusion. Our messaging has to really be important. And what they do is they would actually put these stories together and share with potential customers to say, you know what, we can relate to some of the challenges that you're facing. For example, working with one client in your industry, their challenge was is that they were wasting, they documented more than $125,000 of inventory loss because they just didn't have access to the data. And so they turned to us for a solution, a vendor manager inventory process that would actually consolidate things, track items, and know exactly where everything was going. The good news is, as a result of implementing this process, within the first 6 months, they documented more than $250,000 of savings. Now, whether we can do that for you or not, I have no clue. But would it be okay if I were to ask you a few questions? See how the stories are powerful, persuasive, because they're like, that's my problem. And I want an outcome like that. Our messaging has to do that. Now, my other suggestion to you is that look at some of the trends that's going on. If you want to appeal to, we have to talk people's language. And one of the easiest ways to talk people's language is find out what's going on. It's all there on the internet. And Patrick and I, for example, we got into the agricultural market. We were looking at new opportunities, Patrick, right? And we recognized that agriculture was like the sixth biggest economy globally. And it's like, why aren't we doing business in the ag market? How do we get started? So one of the things we did was, you know, just type it into Google, agricultural challenges and trends, industry trends from 2018 to 2021. And there's your information that surfaces. And the information is accessible. We got to use it and leverage it. Talk people's language. So that's opening, but we want to come back to what we talk about, and that is discovery. Because what Patrick was talking about, the process of disrupting entrenched competitors, I got to develop and cultivate a relationship. And if I can, and the only way to cultivate that relationship is get people talking. Exposing their vulnerabilities, their desires, their hopes, their dreams, their wants. And how do we do that? Well, Patrick and I, when we were putting together the book, Questions That Gets Results, we were really assessing and looking at what are some most common questions that sales and sales leaders are asking when it comes to disrupting entrenched competitors. Patrick, let's go over what some of those questions were, right? The most common questions. Certainly not limited to these questions, but the questions such as, what do you know about us? Or what do you like about us? How are we doing? Or who are you currently using now? What do you like about them? What don't you like about them? There's one thing you would change. What would it be? How are we doing? How can we improve?
And one of the ways, of course, isn't just the question itself. It's how it's proposed. It's how it's asked. Because we can ask a question and get this blank stare, or we can get the response where they're really not telling us the truth, where they're holding information back. So there's definitely not just the question, but there's the skill in how we ask the question. Yeah. And how do we gather that information so that we get people to open up?
And they're putting up this barrier, this veneer And they're not shedding with us when we, when we're dabbling, we're groveling, we're scratching at the surface. So what are your needs? What are your goals? Well, you're here. Well, you tell me. We're happy. We're content. We're really satisfied. Well, do you have any problems? Anything that needs to be? Not really. I think we're content. Or the question is, oh, what are you paying now? How much you paying? What's it costing you? What's your budget? Well, let me ask you, who besides yourself makes these decisions? Am I talking to the right person? Who else do I need to talk to? Do you have the signing authority? And then, of course, now we start really running out of questions to ask. And well, what if I could help you? What if I could show you? What if I could tell you I could save you money? You know what? I could cut your costs, reduce your expenditures. Is this something you'd be interested in? And we kind of chuckle at that question, because what do we say? If you can whisper the following words, or are you stupid? We know it's probably not a good question, right? And the right. reason why we ask a question like that is because what? We're trying to get that bobblehead, right? Where somebody will actually
nod. These are the typical questions that people ask. Is that right?
You're trying. It's a little bit of a form of manipulation. Again, yeah. We're not necessarily knocking these questions. Please understand. We understand the purpose or the intent. Can I get you a quote? Can I come back for a presentation? Can I send you some information or email you something? Or when should I follow up or touch base? Now, are we saying that any of us ask these questions? Or one or two of these questions, or three or four of these questions? The challenge is that you got a limited, how much time do we have before somebody starts shutting us down? And we know the time is little, right? It's minimal. So if we're gonna make a powerful, persuasive impression to a disrupted, entrenched competitor, we got to take that from somebody who's saying, you know what, I'm content, everything's good or whatever, to say, putting the hands down and say, whoa, I want to open up. I do want to talk. And it's funny, that person that says, I only got 5 minutes, tell me what you got, because they're just being very polite to get you out the door or get you off the phone, to something like, you know, where we say, well, you only gave me 5 minutes now. We have two choices. Should we reschedule or continue the conversation? If I hit what's important to them, guess what? All of a sudden, it's amazing how somebody is no longer busy because we've gotten to what's meaningful to them. Isn't that right, Patrick?
Mm-hmm.
So where do we go? What are better, more effective ways to engage somebody so that if I got a one-shot opportunity, otherwise I'm not shut down, I'm going to recommend that you explore these areas. These areas that you want to explore are as follows. We're going to be looking at how do I explore what I call the time area. And I want to talk about time because, you know, many of the questions that we ask, we're fishing, we're groveling, we're scratching at the surface, as I said. What's going on now? What's working? What isn't working? How happy are you? Where could there be improvement? Any problems? Needs? A lot of them are what I call in the present. And if you're not careful, we tend to interrogate, we tend to annoy, we tend to harass or below. So the point is that I'm not opening people up, I'm shutting them down. What I want to rather do is get people to reflect or think of the future. Where do people prefer to be in the future, right? So stop spending so much time in the present. Number two, where is everything you need to sell is where? In the past. And yet, interesting about probably 92% of the questions we ask are in the present. About 7% go into the future and about 2% go into the past. But my recommendation is spend more time in the past and the future.
Isn't the pain more in the past?
The pain is in the past, yes. That's right.
That is the service issues they've had, experienced, the delivery problems, the breakdowns. All of those issues are in the past. I mean, if you walk in the door and you say, are you having any problems? And the customer says, oh yes, just this morning. But usually it doesn't happen that way. This may have happened a month ago or even 6 months ago and cost them a considerable amount of money. But because it's 6 months ago, it's not what they're currently thinking of. So if we ask questions that go back to the past skillfully, we'll gather information more about where the pain is. Is that right?
Yeah. And my recommendation is, you know, forget about the existing vendor competitive relationship. That is not a priority to a disrupting an entrenched competitor. I mean, that is the least of, if somebody is telling you we're satisfied, we're content, you are going down the wrong path. My recommendation is that anybody that you're wanting having a conversation with, anybody attending today's session, think about it. Are you experiencing any change? My next question is a little or a lot, all right? Is it fair to say that as things progress forward, that you're going to experience any more change? And more, the question too is, what about your prospective customers and existing customers? Are they too experiencing change, a little or a lot? The reality is change is here. My recommendation is that focus on engaging them about change. So the way you do that, and I was on a call recently, and this salesperson was selling IT and cloud solutions, cloud-based solutions, calling on a CFO. And it was a classic example where these, you know, the individual said, well, you know, we're really content, everything's good, we're happy, but sure, come on in, I'll be willing to spend a few minutes with you. Anyway, the rep, we went on the joint call, getting to the conversation, the pleasantries, the rapport. And as the rep did a wonderful job, because he asked the question, you know, as we look at, you know, where you're going today, let's take me back to what originally prompted you, what was important to you 3 to 5 years ago when you originally implemented this process. So the CFO started talking about, you know, what was important when it came to data management. And it was all about protecting the data. It was more about making sure the data, the platform could be shared across all divisions and departments. It was uniform and accessible internally. And then the next question was asked, well, how does that compare to where things are today? And so the CFO was reflecting to say, well, what's changed today is the fact is that now it's all about protecting that data, the data because of cyber attacks, the concerns, the risks, our reputation, the leakage. That's a big difference today. How we have to shift gears to really ensure that we don't risk our information or risk our reputation. And then the rep continued, said, as you look, project where things are going to be 3 to 5 years from now, what do you see are going to, is going to change for you and your organization? Mm-hmm. And the CFO said, you know, it's interesting you asked that because it's going to be a big shift from our internal customers to our external customers because our external customers wanted to have access to this information.
Sure.
To share this information, to communicate this information. And it's a big challenge because in the IT, we now have to really wear that hat of sales and customer service. And it's hard for us. And you know, one of the challenges we're facing with our existing vendor is how do we have the mobile applications that are available to our customers? Because we're finding our existing vendor doesn't demonstrate those capabilities. I'm curious about your experience and if that's something that possibly you could help us with. Ah, created a fissure, a gap, an opportunity, mm-hmm. all because went into what I call exploring the time perspectives, the past, the present, and the future. That's okay. Going to be important, folks.
Right? That's excellent. That shows a way to get the customer to open up, to share insights into where these issues are, what challenges that they were, and helps them to really define and control that. And give it some perspective. As a matter of fact, you know, as you were talking about that, I was thinking about the organization that we worked with in Minnesota, where the clients were just, you know, every time they would talk with them, they would give them, you know, polite answers and they wouldn't open up. Remember, there was a fellow by the name of Lance, and what Lance found is that when he went to the time frame, when he asked about the past, he got his customers to open up. He personally, I mean, this individual was close to being replaced in his organization, his boss told us later, but he was able to turn it around and really become one of their top sales individuals on that team simply because he went to the change issue and the time issue. That was profound.
And my when somebody's in the complacent mode, I'm happy, I'm content, everything's good. You want to come back and challenge, kind of shake things up and talk about change. And the other way you get people to really talk about change and shake up complacency, you want to go to the pain and the gain. You want to go to the emotions. How do you do that? And I was working with a rep a year and a half ago, Greater Philadelphia area. And he goes, Paul, I've been calling on this project manager for the last 3 years. And I check in with this person about every 6 months. And he goes, it's classic. Every time I pop in to see this guy, you know, he'll meet me out in the reception area. He's got his hands on his hips, gives me that stare, like, what do you got? And says, well, okay, leave me some literature and, you know, touch base in 6 months and we'll see what goes on. And it's been going on for 3 years. I said, well, let's do the pain and the gain. And he said, how do you do that? And I took him through that. So I prepped him, worked in coaching on the question. And interesting enough, we walked into the lobby, and it was interesting because just like, you know, 2 days ago it snowed. So it was a little bit of rapport to say, oh, what was the challenges coming into work? Yeah, it was a little difficult, but we got through that and so forth. But it was classic because he described this project manager to a T, and that is, the guy literally did come out to the reception area, hands on his hips, gave that stare. The guy's 6'3", looking down at us, and we're like, ugh. And so the rep was just wonderful and said, you know what? When I saw you last year and we were talking about some of the issues, one of the challenges that you shared with me, and we're hearing this from other project managers, was the need to really manage multiple projects, not getting stretched in, the overall costs and longevity and the extended duration where projects get overrun. And it made me think of you, because now the opportunities, what we're seeing this year in the greater Philadelphia, there's a lot of, you know, new infrastructure projects that are taking place, some really good opportunities, particularly when it comes to the financial, the insurance, as well as the services area. And I'm curious what you see are the opportunities moving forward compared to where we were, what we talked about, some of the challenges last year. Beautiful, because he did a pain and gain. And the project director literally drops his hands and says, and raises his hand with a finger, and he says, you know, it's interesting you raise that question, because we were just in a meeting, a strategic meeting, with the board 3 days ago, and having this very same discussion. Hey, why don't you come back to my office? I'd like to just chat with you a little bit about that. And literally 60 minutes later, in a really in-depth conversation, and walked away with a quote opportunity of $400,000, which that sales rep eventually won 8 months later.
Yeah, isn't it interesting?
Let's not fish and grovel. Bring the pain to the people through our research.
The problem.
The marketplace. Isn't that right, Patrick?
Yeah, the problem, of course, is that when you say to the customer, are you currently experiencing any pain? Their answer is, oh, no. No problems at all. Nothing going on. And the way you phrased that question, the way he phrased it with that client, really caused the client to open up, to share, and invite them in. And it's all in the way that question was phrased, because we know basic selling tells us, look for the pain, look for the gain. But getting the customer to open up, I think, was the key in that example that you gave, Paul.
That's right, because if otherwise people are going to put up that veneer, are you having any problems? Nope. We're content. We're satisfied.
Yep.
You know what?
Yep.
You are the eyes and the ears of what's going on in the marketplace. And so what I'm saying is, you can leverage, and you don't have to share confidential or client experiences, but you can say, we need to understand your market and the challenges in your market. There seems to be three challenges: challenge one, challenge two, and challenge three. How does that compare with what you see are some of the challenges, but more importantly, where you see the opportunities for even greater growth and success? People are more willing to open up on that. Now, the other area I want you to be looking at is, because too often we see when it comes to disrupting that entrenched competitor, is that we're going in and we have one or two touch points. What I mean is, we're going at a low level, a mid level, might be even a high level, but you're hanging your hat on one or two people, maybe three, hoping that they have all the answers, the insight, and the ability to cultivate relationships. The reality is, not everybody is a right fit. So when you're getting doors shut down, your job is to better understand the people involved. Now, I'll give you an example, because we were working with an electrical distributor on the West Coast, and it was with a state contract. It was a very competitive bid, and there was some entrenched relationships going on, and they were like, oh, the only way we're really going to get in here is going to really cut our pricing down to the bare bones.
Not good.
Got to find a better strategy than giving up our hard-earned margins, because that's not going to be a good way to not only win the business, but more importantly, keep the business, because we could really lose our neck on this one. I think all of us can relate to that, right? Mm-hmm. So what they did was, in this bid project, because they met with some of the key individuals. So they met with the procurement people. And so one of the questions that came up was, so take us through the decision-making process. And it was interesting, by asking that question, help us understand the decision-making process, what they found out was procurement was involved. And from procurement, then it was going to be operations. After operations, it was going to be the service personnel. Then it was going to be general management. And then it was going to be the contractors and the end users. We had five different parties involved. So all of a sudden, what they were able to leverage that and say, okay, well, let me ask you then, from a procurement standpoint, from your perspective, help us understand what's important to you. The question is, help us understand how you define value. What's going to be important to you to ensure this project is going to be successful? Well, of course, from the purchasing procurement, they were saying pricing. Pricing is going to be really important. We got to have apple to apples. This has got to look good. But as they get into the conversation, said, help us understand as you move forward in the process, from those in operations, from the operations standpoint, help us understand what they value. And all of a sudden, there was a different criteria. And that was, it was all about responsiveness. It was all about service. And then it moved on and they asked the question, okay, engineering, they found that was involved. All of a sudden, quality now. So tell us what engineering really values, quality. Tell us why that's so important. And then what they were able to find out was the history. The history, the challenges, frustrations with the existing vendor, where they weren't living up to the expectations. There was some financial penalties, implications, some costs, overruns. And they found that there was risks involved. And then from the end user, what they also, and what they uncovered is that they didn't have to lower their price. They found out the decision-making process, and they got the customers to define specifically what they value, why, so they could present a viable, specific, meaningful solution that was so packaged and precise so that people had to buy.
Paul, right? All of this started from a criteria question.
Yes.
Give me that criteria question again.
Help me understand, from your perspective, what do you value?
Okay.
From what's important to you? And that's what's important to your peers? What's important to your cohorts? What's important to your boss? What's important to your customers? What's important to your company?
Now I'm getting, because in many cases with these entrenched competitors, it's a complex sale. It's not as easy going in and talking to one person. I've got to go to engineering. I've got to take it through procurement. I've got to take it through the buying process. Then the CEO wants to give his input. And in some cases, the decision maker is not even the CEO. It's the human resource director or the head of engineering. So it really changes depending on the account that you go to. But all of those are influencers in the sale.
And so some of you are saying right now, well, yeah, I go to the people who make the decision. Well, yeah. But the question is, have you ever gotten blocked and tackled by somebody who said, no, you don't need to talk to anybody else but me? Well, if you face that, what that tells you is what they're hinting at, go back to the 80% of the time they're not telling you what is on their minds. They're not telling you the truth. They're claiming they're the decision maker when they really aren't. They're claiming what is important when it comes to value. They don't really know. They're hiding. So your job is to say, so that I have a really good understanding. I really appreciate that. Let's do this. Let's have you. Let's have me. Let's have operations. Let's have engineering. Let's have the CEO. Let's have all the parties involved. Introduce me to those people, because I want to have a complete and thorough understanding of your needs, the company's needs, the customer's needs, so that when I put together a recommendation, it's going to be meaningful, it's going to be impactful, it's going to benefit you and everyone involved. When you have good relationships in place to disrupt an entrenched competitor, they're going to say, yes, I'll introduce you, because they trust you. They have confidence in you that you're going to make them look good. You're going to make them look like a hero. You're going to make them shine. People open up doors. They don't block doors. They block doors when we don't have relationships. That's why we're driving home this discovery process, why it's so important, and why you want to master these concepts that'll make truly a difference between being average at what you do and making what is outstanding. The one other area we do want to drive home, though, is, you know, when we ask people, are you happy? Are you content? The fact is, no. Our better way of really is finding out that wedge, any disparity, even if it's slight, it's understanding, you know, help me understand. And don't ask the question, what do you like or what don't you like about your existing vendor? That, don't ask that question, because you're not going to get to the truth, right? You think you're, unless you step on something that is a goldmine by luck, where it just happens to be where you timed it well, that they really aren't happy. Yes, you can go there. But if you're fishing or groveling, not a good question. And you don't get the answer you like. Better way is, help me understand the ideal qualities you look for in a vendor or a vendor relationship, because they're going to give you the criteria. Well, what we look for is, we look for service, we look for quality, we look for integrity, we look for responsiveness, and of course we look for price. All those, they're going to give you a criteria. And when they give you a criteria, that allows you then to really zero in and say, you know, these four criteria, putting the price aside, of course, tell me which of these four is most important to you. And it's interesting, they'll give you that criteria. Well, it's integrity. Really? Why did you choose? Tell me more about why you chose integrity.
Right.
Well, because we look for vendors that really are going to practice what they say. They're going to be honest and forthright. Well, give me an example. Obviously, that's a situation of something that's happened in the past. Can you elaborate on that? Oh, yeah. We had something about 2 months ago. Person promised that this would be delivered within two days. It was a week later. We had all these contractors and personnel standing around. Really? Oh, and we couldn't get it delivered on time? You're kidding me. So what did this cost you in terms of time and resources? Are you kidding me? This was a $120,000 problem. All of a sudden, and this was a real live situation. Well, help me understand your concerns if something like this were to occur again. We're not even going to allow that to happen, because that's one of the reasons why I was willing to sit down and talk to you. Ah, you see, you've gotten somewhere I call a little wedge to find out a bigger, bigger opportunity. Okay. But you've got to dig for it.
All right, Paul, let's bring it to the conclusion. Let's wrap it all up, because we've got some questions and answers coming.
Yep. All right. So what we're going to recommend is, we've given you the answers. The most powerful persuasive solution that you want to craft, whether it's your USP, your elevator pitch, or to drive home how you can be of value to your customers, the answers are with your customers. And what our recommendation is, stop giving the feature benefit dump.
Right. We had one sales manager in Denver say, unfortunately, some of our people that show up and throw up, meaning that they show up and then, of course, give this absolute feature and benefit dump. And it just, it hits, it does not stick, it's not relevant, and it's not apropos.
We've given you the examples how you, by you digging and understanding the information, why you ask good questions, because all of a sudden you find out, help me understand what this is costing you in terms of time, opportunities, resources, customers, productivity, effort, employee turnover. When you can quantify a problem, all of a sudden you are putting logic to, you've gotten to the emotions, but you're also justifying the actions with logic. So they no longer look at you as a cost, but look at you as a return on investment. But it's your job, not theirs, to demonstrate that return on investment. Like I gave you the example of the snack food manufacturing, to find out there's a quarter million dollar problem. And all of a sudden you dig deeper because you talk to other people involved and you found out that, one customer that's worth $6 million is going to pull the plug because they're not getting the bags of chips at all their convenience stores throughout the tri-state area. All of a sudden now you find out, wow, you know what? Yeah, you may be the highest investment in terms of that, you know, $750,000 machinery, but if it's going to impact, you know, a $6 million opportunity, you are the lowest total cost.
Yeah, I love the quantifying things.
You have to.
The dollars sign on it, it just adds a whole new dimension.
You can't be lazy here. You can't be. And we want to do our dog and pony. Mm-hmm. You know, the one litmus test of a good quality call to disrupt an entrenched competitor, we did most of the talking. If you did most of the talking to try to convince, persuade and motivate that person to sway them over to you, not a good call. Get them talking.
Okay, that's good.
All right. So, all right, we're going to ask you, though, is what's your number one challenge when it comes to disrupting entrenched competitors? All right, we got a question from Tom. And Tom is asking the question here in terms of when it comes to disrupting an entrenched competitor, what they face is price. How do I overcome the price discussion? Because they just drive home and say, you know what, give me a better price. And I can relate to what Tom is saying, because how many of us have actually tried to sway or motivate a prospective customer? You end up really sharpening your pencil, and I mean, you are convinced that they're going to go, ooh, ah, wow, and fall all over and want to step in and do business with you. And what happens? Too often the answer is nothing. And why is that, Patrick? Why is it that price, especially if we have the opportunity to come in and undercut the competitors, why doesn't that work?
You know, it's like comparing and shooting in the dark. It's like walking in the door and saying and assuming that price is the number one issue, assuming that everybody would change who they're working with based on price, particularly if you're selling engineering services. If you're selling engineering services, it's not a question of price. It really goes back to the questions where you asked, what is the buying criteria? Help me and the beautiful question, help me understand what the buying criteria here is in the organization. All of a sudden it takes you through the different steps where those services need to be sold, who the decision makers are in those steps, or how they influence the sale. You can have the best product, the best service, the best price, and still not get the business because there's someone along the line in that process who's you know, throwing up a blockage.
That's right.
Causing the sale not to go through.
Now, so, there's this recent study by 5,000 C-level buyers. 5,000 C, and what they found is that 19% of purchases were due to quality of service, another 19% due to reputation, 9% due to price, 53% were due to the quality of the interaction and the relationship between the sales professional and that organization. That's why we're talking about cultivating, developing, and managing the relationship. If you're trying to do it on price, too often you're going to lose. My suggestion is when somebody pushes you on price as an opportunity to engage, to disrupt and get in there, hoping that you will disrupt the entrenched competitor, get in there and understand what they value. All because too often price is not the motivating factor.
Right.
Unless you're Walmart.
There's a question that says, okay, how do I get them to even give us a shot? How do I get in and open the door? And all of that goes back to the answer to that question is in the research step. How much do you know about them? How much do you really, and of course, there are many places we can go to get this information, but we've got to have the information before we even have the right to get in front of them. Why would I allow you to talk to me if you don't even know what my issues are and what my problems are on a general basis? I can personalize them in the actual presentation, but before you actually talk to me, you better know or have a good feel for who I am and what my issues are. That's where it all begins.
That's right. That's right. We got Susan has a question. She sells laboratory equipment solutions. And her challenge is that she's walking in, calling on receptionists, and too often receptionists will say, nope, do you have somebody that you're here to see? No, and she's fishing around asking for who would be responsible for making purchasing decisions when it comes to laboratory equipment. And of course, the feedback is, well, I'm not allowed to give out that information. Susan wants to know, how does she get around that so that the receptionist will give her that viable information? And the answer is, you know, in the post 9/11 situations, a lot of organizations are more shy. They're not allowed to disclose contacts and information. And I assume you're selling to what I call the biological, the pharmaceutical, healthcare marketplace. My recommendation is planning is going to be key. You know, we have the LinkedIn, the social media. Go to the book, Sam Richter, that I told you about. Find out. We worked with one organization, and that's what they did was they networked with trade associations. Trade associations, mm-hmm. Because they found that key contacts and were able to get referrals. Referrals, that's probably your most powerful way to get new contacts is leverage referrals. And that is, you know, who are two or three individuals that you admire right. and respect within your circle of influence. That would be willing to, I could stop by and share a few ideas and how they can be more profitable, be more successful. have a more safer operation.
That's good. That's good. Use the referrals. We have a question from Mike, and Mike says, okay, my company had an issue in 2008, and as a result, we lost the business. And now how do I get back in, and how do I get them to listen to me? The best way I know is to say to the customer, as I understand it, your question is, what have we done since 2008 to change, improve, and to make ourselves more competitive? Let me explain a couple of the things that we've done in order to do that, and gear those things that you've done right around what the values of the customer are, right around exactly what the customer is looking for. Repeat that, we ask the customer, so your question is, what have we done since 2008 to improve our processes, to overcome these issues, and to make ourselves more competitive? Mm-hmm. The answer to those questions are exactly what the customer needs are and what's most important to the customer.
Mm-hmm. I got a question with Bill. Bill is asking the question in terms of, you know, by the people that we call on to try to disrupt an entrenched competitor, they get kickbacks, they get incentives, spiffs, tickets, all kinds of incentives. How do I overcome that? You know, when they got the fishing trips, we got hunting trips, the sports events, you know, going out to dinner and all that. It's sort of like the good old buddy system. You know, I know exactly where you're coming from. And the challenge is that recognize that in today's selling environment, hopefully we're seeing less and less of that. Because here's what the reality is. You know, anybody that you call on, organizations today, you know, whether it's nonprofits or for-profit companies, even government, the number one reason, they don't say the number one reason why we're in business today is to take care of our existing vendor relationships. That's absurd. So when somebody is saying, I'm content, I'm happy, everything's good or whatever, you're not addressing the real needs. That's why our challenge is, don't even get on that page about what's going on with the existing vendor, how they meet your needs, where could they improve, where could they how can we get more of that fair share of the business? The point is, it's really understanding more about their desires, wants, hopes, challenges, frustrations. Why? How they can be more profitable, how they can be more successful, how they can make their lives easier, more efficient, minimize some of the risks and anxieties. If you can go there to those emotional drivers, that's where the opportunities are to explore. Patrick, we're running out of time. Any other questions on your end that you?
No, I'm good. I'm trying to see if we've answered pretty much the question. Of course, the last question comes for suggestions in the promotional industry, and there I think the idea is to find out, research your customer, research, and then come up with something that's unique in the promotional area that would be attractive to that customer. The beautiful part about that industry is there's tremendous amount of creativity, and use that to your advantage is what we would say.
Yeah, to wrap that up, that's a good point. We were working with an organization on promotional products, and it's all about selling. They were selling T-shirts, coffee cups, and things like that. Talk about commoditization price.
Yeah.
And you know, the sales rep was calling on companies saying, hey, can I give you a quote or whatever? And it's like, no. What, you know, if you're going in at that angle about to trying to sell cups, T-shirts, and gadgets or whatever, you just, and every time people, we're satisfied, we're okay, everything's good, check back with me in a year. And we told them to change the messaging. And the messaging is, what do they really want? They don't want cups or trinkets or T-shirts. What do they really want? And the needs are, how do they improve employee retention? How do they better meet the needs of their existing customers? How do they attract new customers? So your incentives, your messaging really has to be about, you have some ideas on how you can improve the morale, the motivation, the branding, how you can differentiate that organization from some of the competitive threats. And the ideas is, you know, what you offer, but you got to sell a concept, not a product. And they were able to really shift, to really grow their business by 50% by focusing on the conceptual ideas, not the product.
I think one of the ways to close this then is to talk about or say that one of the keys in working with any business that you want to chase and follow is persistence. You need to stick with it and do it again and find different ways and different contacts and contact them again, again, and again, and again, and not give up.
That's right. Persistence, but with the right people, the right opportunities, and the right questions. All right. Be on the lookout. We have more to come. More ideas about how to disrupt the entrenched competitor. Strategies and techniques. So look for your inbox. Heads up on that, because we're excited to share with you to ensure that as 2018 and beyond is upon us, that is going to be your best of the best year yet. Because if you're not going to get new business from prospectives, how do you steal the opportunities from the competitors where you truly outshine them? You just got to engage and dig for the information and get those people to listen to you, and they will. On behalf of Patrick Connor and myself and the performance-based team, including David Byers, thank you for joining us today. To your sales success.
Good selling.